So, let's start. Recent studies on prehistoric Crete have raised serious doubts about the existence of a single Minoan culture and have questioned the assumption that the island was inhabited by a single population with a more or less homogeneous culture. This is particularly the case for the beginning of the Early Minoan Age, around 3000 BC, which is traditionally regarded as the formative phases of the so-called Minoan culture. Furthermore, recent studies on Prepalatial Crete have shifted their interest from traditional island-wide models to a series of local trajectories and from the large to a small scale of analysis, whether geographic regions or human groups. Terms such as divergent socioeconomic trajectories, regional variability, and cultural diversity are used to describe and explain the existing archaeological record. On this basis, it has been suggested that Prepalatial Crete is not a uniform subject of study, but should be rather studied in terms of its diversity. Regional differences in cultural practices, ceramic production, stylistic traits, consumption choices, and value systems have been suggested, raising questions about the possible coexistence of different ethnic and cultural groups in Crete during this period. Also, the appearance of new elements in the material culture of the final Neolithic and the beginning of the Early Bronze Age have led several scholars to argue for major population movements and the colonization of Crete. The Prepalatial mortuary record has intensively been the focus of such studies, mostly because it shows a high degree of regional diversity, and indeed the round-built communal thorus tombs have a regionally specific distribution, almost exclusively in the Sterousia Messara region in south-central Crete. Such tombs are so rare outside this region that it has often been used as clear evidence for the existence of a well-defined cultural and perhaps ethnic group in the Sterousia Messara area, different from other population groups living in the rest of the island. Within the above context, the recent excavation of two early thorus tombs at Mesorachi and Livari in the far east of Crete allows us to discuss the above issues under the light of new evidence. Both tombs were unearthed between 2008 and 2010 during rescue excavations of the 24th ephorate of prehistoric and classical antiquities conducted by its director, Christos Ofianou, and myself. Their study is in advanced stage and the first reports have already been published. Let's start with Mesorachi. The site of Mesorachi lies 4 kilometers west of Sitia on a narrow saddle between two deep gorges which are running northwards, giving out on the Aegean Sea. Although the sea is only 1 kilometer to the north and visible over the horizon, access to the seashore is rather difficult because of the steep slopes surrounding the site. The Mesorachi Tholos tomb follows many of the architectural features of the Messara tombs. It is 3.2 meters in diameter and built directly on the bedrock. The ratio between the interior diameter and the wall thickness is 3.55, suggesting that the tomb could have had a corbelled roof. The wall was built with large undressed blocks inside and outside, with smaller stones placed in between or the base of the wall as wedges. The entrance is located to the southeast. It is flanked by two vertical flat stones, like many early thorus tombs in the Messara and the Sterousia. The tomb had suffered serious looting and disturbance before the excavation. The only remnant of the original burial stratum was a small and disturbed pocket of soil containing a few human bones, some stone beads, fragments of a copper artifact, and an intact ball of the Patera type, dated to the very beginning of the Early Minoan I, the EM1A phase around 3000 BC. The corresponding habitation site was located on top of a low hill about 50 meters to the northeast of the tomb. The original deposits had long been eroded away. All the pottery belongs to types with good parallels from the neighboring EM1A settlement of Kefala Petras. Again, another view. And here is Kefala Petras next to Mesorachi. The finds include a large number of pithoi cells with relief decoration, which have parallels from the neighboring site at Kefala Petras, from where they were probably imported. Also, you can see here another type of dark grey Bernese thick cities, again with parallels from Cephalopetras, and white and washed whole mouth jars, again with parallels from Cephalopetras. An intensive survey in the broader area proved to be particularly informative concerning the long-term patterns of habitation in Mesorahi and the neighboring area of Sopata. Both areas are flat, heavily eroded, with thin soil deposits and large areas of exposed bedrock. Deep gorges and steep high cliffs increase the isolation of the area, and the access to and from the sea is rather difficult. Furthermore, the area has difficult access from all major habitation centers in the remote and recent past, and is very far from any major communication routes. The survey produced six sites dated to the final Neolithic and Early Minoan one of the final Neolithic and five of the Early Minoan I period, two Middle Minoan and one Late Minoan site, one archaic site, and eight modern farmsteads. The underrepresentation of Middle Minoan, Late Minoan, and Archaic periods, and the lack of classical, Hellenistic, Roman, Byzantine, and Venetian material showed that the area was focused of intensive habitation in only two periods, Final Neolithic Early Minoan I, around 3000 BC, and the 19th 20th century AD. The earliest habitation is dated to the end of the Final Neolithic period. The site of this phase seems to have been a relatively large village, where the entire population of the area was concentrated. Search has scattered over a large area and includes ceramic forms typical of the end of the Final Neolithic, just before the beginning of the Early Bronze Age. Obsidian blades testify access to off-island resources, perhaps through the large neighboring coastal settlement at Cephalopetras, which acted as a gateway community since the Final Neolithic period. Finally, large quantities of mud brick fragments indicate houses made of this material. In Early Minoan I, the settlement pattern changes completely, from a single settlement at Sopata to several small dispersed farmsteads in Mesorahi. Test excavations in two sites reveal important information about the size and character of these farmsteads. The first site, about 300 meters southwest of the Tholos Dome, produced a curvilinear wall belonging to an oval building measuring 15 by 10 meters. The ceramic assemblage comprises calcite tempered pottery of Cycladic type, the so-called Campos group pottery. This pottery is dated to the EM1B phase and has strong links with pottery from Aleppo. Here you can see again the Mesorahi in relationship to Aleppo Petras. The second site, about 300 meters northwest of the Tholos Dome, produced a large oval undisturbed building measuring 18 by 13 meters with evidence for processing cereals. The ceramic material is also dated to the EM1B period and comprised calcite tempered pottery of Cycladic type as well as typical Cretan ceramic types such as painted Agios Onuphrios ware and dark grey Bernese Pyrgos ware. This excavation took place last September, and the material is currently under study by Chrysa Sufianou, Tom Brogan, and myself. Here you can see an aerial photo of the building. Let's move now to Livari. Livari is a small coastal plain on the south coast at the southeast corner of Crete. The closest big centers of Minoan habitation are Zagros and Makrigalos. The area has a constant water supply, but it is a rather marginal agricultural environment. You can see it from here. This is the map of the site. A surface survey by Norbert Slager of the Austrian Academy identified an early Minoan Tholos cemetery at Skiadi, a final Neolithic settlement on top of the steep hill of Katharades, an early Minoan settlement on the south and east slopes of Castrokefalaki, 350 meters north of the cemetery, and a Middle Minoan, Late Minoan settlement on the south slopes of Hieromilia, 200 meters west of the cemetery. The cemetery now lies about 50 meters from the seashore on a small rocky promontory at the end of the Olowaras Gorge at the southern edge of the plain. Again, the sites as seen from the sea. Again, another view of the area. With the arrow, you can see the Tholos cemetery. And in the cemetery now, the excavations, again another view. This is the view from the Castrokefalaki settlement, so you can see the relationship between the cemetery and the settlement, the corresponding settlement. And now, to the cemetery, the excavations revealed a secure Orthodox tomb of the Mesara type and a burial rock shelter used for burials between Early Minoan 1b and the end 3 period. Small deposits of the same period in open areas around the Orthodox tomb, which correspond to non-funeral rituals, and a house tomb of the Neo-Palaeocene period, which will not concern us today. Again, the three areas I was speaking about. Let's see, now. Let's go to the Orthodox tomb. The structure is a typical circular Orthodox tomb, showing many similarities with tombs of the Masara and the Asterousia. This is the picture just before the beginning of the excavation. You can see the line, the circle of the Orthodox tomb before the excavation. It has an internal diameter of 4 by 4.4 meters and a wall thickness of 1.2 meters. The wall consists of two faces built of large irregular stones with small irregular stone wedges fitted at the base of the wall to secure stability. The entrance is to the southeast, in agreement with the majority of the Mesara Asterousia Orthodox tombs, probably indicating similar beliefs concerning sun and the sunrise. Apart from the above similarities, however, there is an interesting deviation from the Mesara Asterousia Orthodox tombs. At the west and south part of the tomb, a thin outer ring was attached to the outer face of the wall. Similar outer rings exist in several tholoi in the Mesara Asterousia and are usually regarded as structures to provide additional strength to the main tholos wall, usually added in subsequent phases. At Livari, however, it was built as part of the original construction, and its purpose was to strengthen the main. Its purpose was not to strengthen the main wall, because in this case it would expect it to be built in the sloping east side, where the pressures of the substructure will be higher. It is possible, therefore, that the outer ring was adopted at Livari as an imitation of a construction practice seen in the Mesara and Asterousia, although it was not a technical and architectural necessity. About 10 meters west of the Tholos tomb, there is a large projecting mass of the natural bedrock, rising almost vertically up to 3 meters from the surrounding ground. In the interior of this formation, there are three chambers connected to each other through small openings. Chamber 1 has been recently paved with cement, that's why we were unable to excavate it. You can see it before the pavement and after. Chamber 3 was found completely empty, but chamber 2 produced large quantities of funerary material found inside a deep soil stratum almost 1 meter thick. This is the entrance of the small chamber 2, and this is the thick soil stratum with the funerary material. The area surrounding the Tholos tomb was excavated into the bedrock. The original Minoan deposits had been eroded away, with the exception of two deposits which were found undisturbed in the areas dotted, pointed with red color. This is the first area. We will see the second later. The human bones are under study by Dr. Sevi Triadafili of the University of Thessaloniki. As in all the Mesara Asterousia Tholos tombs, the Livari Tholos contained a large quantity of skeletal remains, indicating a communal burial place used by a large population group, perhaps the entire community. No articulated skeleton or skeletal parts were found, and many bones show extreme fragmentation, suggesting prolonged use and repeated visits of the living inside the tomb to bury their dead. Again, a feature typical to all the Tholos tombs of the Mesara Asterousia area. It is of particular interest that 50% of the human bones from the Tholos show clear traces of burning under very high temperatures, as evidenced by discolorations, distortions, and cracking of the bone surface. Distortion, in particular, clearly suggests that at least some of the bones were heavily burned when flesh was still preserved on some of them. What should be noted, however, is that the tomb itself produced absolutely no evidence of fire, no charcoal fragments or ash deposits, no black areas or discolorations in the soil and the tholos walls. This clearly suggests that the bones were not buried inside the tholos, but in another yet unknown area of the cemetery. The human bones found in the rock shelter are in a much better condition, often preserved intact and with no traces of burning. The above picture implies, or at least this is what we believe at the moment, that burial, as in other Tholos cemeteries, was a lengthy and systematic process but involved different rituals than those documented so far in the rest of the island. Primary burials were not made originally inside the Tholos tomb, in contrast to what we believe for the rest of the Cretan cemeteries, but in another part of the cemetery. The burial rock shelter could have been the area of the original interment, as suggested by the condition of the bones. After a certain period of time, some of the skeletal remains were transferred to the Tholos, which was their final resting place. Most probably, it is particularly at this stage of the burial process that the bones were burned together with funerary offerings in high temperatures. This procedure could be part of special rituals that signaled the removal of the bones from their original place of interment to the Tholos tomb. So, burnt human bones have been identified in several other Tholos tombs in the Mesara and the Estherousia, but in significantly smaller frequencies, suggesting that they are the result of hasty and short-term process, perhaps fumigation fires and cleansing. Also, in all these cases, there are traces of burning within the Tholos tomb itself. In Livari, however, it is clear that we have intentional cremation of human remains happening outside the Tholos. Traces of burning are also seen in the funerary offerings, the pottery, the metal, the stone artifacts, even the obsidian plates, suggesting that many of them were thrown in the fire together with the human bones. Here you can see some burnt shirts together with pieces of bones attached on there because of the fire. There is an interesting case of a drop from a melted copper object adhered on a heavily burned pottery shell, suggesting that fires reached high temperatures, well above 1000 degrees, and for sufficient time, causing metal objects to melt down. On the basis of the above, it could be suggested that these fire rituals did not signal only the physical act of removing the bones to their final resting place, but also the metaphysical process of transferring the dead into the world of the ancestors. In this case, the Tholos tomb of Libari was not so much the house of the dead, as traditionally thought for Cretan Tholos tombs, but rather the house of the ancestors. We move now to the pottery from Libari. Almost 50% of the pottery is dated to Early Minoan 1b to A phases, while Early Minoan 2b and 3 pottery is significantly less than 10% of the total. Thus, it seems that the main period of use is between 2800 and 2400 BC. Burials continued in the second half of the third millennium, but the use of the cemetery does not appear to be so intense. In Early Minoan 1b to A period, the largest number of vases, about 30%, belongs to dark grey burnished ware, the so-called pyrgos ware. This was used almost exclusively for drinking vases, mostly chalices and a few cups, and for medium or small storage vases, namely pyxidries. Most of these vases were manufactured in the broader area of Livari, but there are also imported specimens coming mostly from the Estherousia. The second most frequent ware, representing also 30% of the total, is the dark on light painted ware, also known as Agios Onuprios ware. The same repertoire is rather limited, almost exclusively for pouring vases, jugs in particular. You can see some examples here. And a single pixie in this type of ware. Most of the painted vases were made in the broader area of Livari, but petrographic analysis carried out by Eleni Nodaro showed also some imports from the Estherousia and the Mirabello. Both the dark grey burnished and the dark on light painted wares have good parallels from all over Crete, and they constitute typical features in any Early Minoan 1-2A ceramic assemblage anywhere on the island. Also, despite the existence of imports, most of the vases were manufactured in the broader area of Livari. The third most frequent ware, however, constitutes an anomaly. It is the dark burnished ware, to which belong about 20% of the vases from the cemetery. It is distinguished by the calcite tempered fabric, which was used only for this ware and has close affinities with pottery from North Crete and the Cyclades, and is often called campus group pottery. The safe repertoire is rather limited, almost exclusively pyxides and a few chalices, bowls and cups. Until now, this pottery was considered as imported to Crete from the Cyclades. Recent studies, however, have shown that most of it was produced in North Crete under strong Cycladic influence. Also, until now, it was considered as a strictly North Cretan phenomenon and was related to the strong connections that the sites of the North Cretan coastline had developed with the Cycladic world. However, this should be reconsidered on the basis of evidence from Livar. Undoubtedly, this pottery was not a local product, but was imported to Livari either from the north coast or from the Cyclades through sites of the north coast. What depresses us most is that we are not dealing with a couple of rare and exotic imports, but with at least 60 vases and many more sets, corresponding to 20% of the total. Petrographic analysis also showed a variety of at least 4 different fabrics, suggesting that such vases were imported to Livari from more than one production center. In EM2B, the cemetery continues into EM2B and EM3 phases, but the amount of the pottery decreases significantly, suggesting a less frequent use. In Early Minoan 2B, the most characteristic pottery is the basilική ware. It is rather rare, about 1% of the total, and includes vases for pouring, mostly jugs and drinking, small cups and goblets. According to petrographic analysis, it was imported to Livari from the Mirabello and the Sterusia. Finally, in EM3, the most characteristic ware is red-black slip, often with white painted decoration of simple linear patterns, and was also used for pouring vases, namely jugs, and drinking vases, namely cups. In terms of pottery function, the Livari cemetery follows features and trends seen in the follow cemeteries of the Mestara Asterusia area. In Early Minoan 1-2a, the vast majority of the vases are burnished and painted pyxides, burnished chalices and painted jugs. This suggests a highly typified mortuary ritual involving first food offerings made inside pyxides, which were then placed with the dead inside the tomb, and second, the consumption of liquids with the use of painted jugs and burnished chalices, which due to their large size were not individual drinking vases, but were used rather collectively by all the participants of the use of the ritual. In the later phases, the picture changes completely. The pyxides disappear. Most of the pottery belongs to pouring jugs made in basilική ware or red-black slit ware, and small cups and goblets for individual drinking made in white painted ware. The complete disappearance of pyxides after Early Minoan 2a is a phenomenon seen in many other follow cemeteries, and it seems to be related to changes in mortuary practices. However, it is difficult to define these changes more precisely, since the function of pyxides remains largely unknown. It is generally accepted, however, that they contained foodstuff deposited inside the tomb together with the dead for the afterlife. If this is accepted, the disappearance of the pyxides may indicate changes in their ideas and beliefs concerning death and the afterlife. A second change from Early Minoan 1 to Early Minoan 3 is the gradual diminution of the principal drinking vase. The large communal chalices of Early Minoan 1 were replaced by the smaller goblets of Early Minoan 2a, which were then replaced by even smaller individual goblets and cups in Early Minoan 2b and EM3. This change has also been observed in several follow cemeteries of the Mesara Asterusia area and has been used as evidence for changes in the social meaning of drinking rituals and in the number of the participants. The study of the spatial distribution of the various function categories gives also valuable information concerning the character of each deposit and the way it was formed. In the Tholos tomb and the burial rock shelter, the vast majority of the diagnostic material belongs to pyxides, which comprise up to 65% of the assemblage, while drinking, pouring and serving vessels constitute about 10% each. On the contrary, the percentages in the open areas are around the Tholos tomb, show a completely different picture. About half, 47% of the vases belong to pouring vases, namely jugs, while vases for drinking and serving represent about 20% each. The above clearly suggests that the assemblages of the open areas have a different character than the Tholos and the rock shelter, probably formed by different mortuary practices and rituals. This is reinforced by the complete lack of human bones and any other funerary offerings such as jewelry, metalwork, seals in the open areas. It seems clear that the area surrounding the tholos were not funerary deposits or funerary material cleared from the tombs, but rather the result of new non-funerary drinking or libation rituals. Again, this is a feature seen very often in main cemeteries of Mesara and the Asterousia. You can see one of these areas, a group of five Early Minoan jars, just outside the entrance of the tholos tomb, and this is the big deposit, again, outside the tholos tomb, with many jars. The cemetery produced a rather small assemblage of metal artifacts, half of which belong to simple two-pointed poles. Of particular importance is the group of five daggers found in the cemetery. The quantity is relatively small when compared to the rich cemeteries of the Mesara, but it is comparable to cemeteries of the Asterousia. The chemical composition of the daggers varies. Two midrib daggers are made of copper and silver alloy. The latter was deliberately addition to copper, probably in order to give a lighter silver color to the finished product. The other three daggers are made of arsenic copper. Apart from several simple stone pendants and beads, there are some pieces of jewelry that deserve a more detailed discussion. The rock shelter produced three ring-shaped pendants, one made of pure silver and the other two made of copper-silver alloy. These pendants have exact parallels from Agios Onuvios in the Mesara, and they were probably imported from there. You can see the parallels from the Mesara to your right. Two anchor-shaped pendants are made of pure silver and they have exact parallels from Krasi and Petras in North Crete. Again, to the left, Livari, to the right, similar pendant of Krasi. A silver vase-shaped pendant is identical to one from Krasi and has also parallels in pinheads from Naxos in the Cyclades. A silver flat discoid bead with tubular midrib string holes has good parallels in silver and gold in the treasures of Aegina, Thriatis, Polyogne, Troy and the Middle East, but a similar silver bead has been also found in Monio Digitria in the Asterousia. A bone bifurcated object and some bone drop-shaped pendants have exact parallels from Phormi in North Central Crete. Other special finds include seals made of stone, bone and hippopotamus ivory, which on the basis of their typology were most probably imported from the Mesara Asterousia area. The above show that several funerary offerings were imported to Livari from distant areas, including the Mesara, Northeast and North Central Crete. Due to their rarity and exotic character, they could signal special identities or statuses within the local community. What should be emphasized, however, is the variety in the origin of these imports, something rather surprising for such a remote site like Livari. Finally, interesting information derives from the obsidian tools which are under study by Tristan Carter. As in many other Cretan funerary contexts, the obsidian chipped stone tools show little trace of pre-depositional wear, suggesting that they were specifically manufactured with burial in mind. Their rarity may have been one of their most attractive features, since their procurement and funerary consumption would have provided social significance to the associated dead. The practice of depositing unused fine pressure flake bray blades, which have been manufactured specifically for funerary rites, seems to have emerged in the early Bronze Age and Cyclades and was subsequently adopted by overseas communities. In terms of their technical and typological characteristics, however, the blades from Livari were produced and consumed in a way much closer to the Mesara and the Asterousia rather than to North Cretan or Cyclade communities. Let's move to the discussion. More than a century of archaeological investigations in Crete has shown that the majority of the 78 Prepalatial Tholos tombs are distributed in the plain of Mesara and on the slopes of the Asterousian mountains in south central Crete. The earliest of these tombs were established in the beginning of the Early Minoan One in the southern slopes of the Mesara, of the Asterousia, and towards the end of Early Minoan One and in Early Minoan Two, they spread northwards to the Mesara plain. There are only 8 certain tholos tombs outside this area, 4, uh, For in the north part of the island, Achanes Gamma and Epsilon, Gypsades and Crassi Alpha, one in the south, Chondrus Vianum, and three in the east, Mycenae and the Aegea Photia A and B. With the only exception of Crassi, which is dated to Early Minoan 1b, all the other tombs were established in Early Minoan 2, Middle Minoan 1, and Middle Minoan 2. On the basis of the above, the Tholos tombs are traditionally regarded as evidence for the existence of a geographically bounded population group which is of different origin and belongs to a different cultural or ethnic identity in relation to populations in other areas in Crete. Consequently, the few Tholos tombs outside the Mesara are often regarded as the result of immigration and population movement from southeastern Crete to other areas of the island. From this point of view, the Tholos cemeteries at Mesorech and Livari constitute an anomaly to our present knowledge and raise several questions on issues of identity, cultural integration, and population movements in Prepalatial Crete. Concerning the Mesorech Tholos, it is the easternmost Tholos tomb identified until present, quite far from the closest tombs at Crassi and Livari, and with no examples in intervening ear areas. Moreover, the dating of the tomb in Early Minoan 1a means that it is contemporary with the earliest tombs of the Esterousia at a period when there were no such tombs even in the Mesara plain itself. Furthermore, it is difficult to consider the Mesorech Tholos as the result of some sort of population movement from south-central to northeast Crete. The large distance between these two areas, the remote and isolated location, and the lack of similar Tholos tombs in the region and also in intervening areas, make this suggestion rather improbable. There is no reasonable explanation why a small population group, not more than a couple of families, would leave the fertile plain of south-central Crete, which in Early Minoan 1 was rather sparsely populated, move towards far east of Crete, and after many days or weeks, choose to settle in this rather marginal location, Mesorech. We believe that the idea for the emergence of this type of burial facility in the Mesara-Asterousia area and the subsequent spread to the rest of the island through population movements should be reconsidered. On the other hand, the adoption of the Tholos tomb type by the people of Mesorech should not be seen unrelated to the mortuary practices of south-central Crete at this early period. Despite the long distance, it is difficult to accept that the people of Mesorech were not aware of the contemporary Tholos tombs in the Asterousia. They did not simply imitate the architectural form of a circular structure that they may have seen elsewhere, but they also adapted the characteristic of the east-oriented entrance, a powerful symbolical feature connecting death with sunrise at particular times of the year. The case of Livari is somewhat different, and the adoption of the Tholos tomb can be more easily explained. Although the area seems isolated, the connection with Asterousia must have been rather easy via the sea routes along the south coast. Although we are still missing many intervening links, it seems that such a sea route was already active since the early Prepalatial period. The connection with Mesara and Asterousia is also reinforced by the importation of many finished products, such as pottery, seeds, and jewelry. Furthermore, the people of Livari adopted also ideas and symbolisms that they are associated with death and the dead. The use of a communal Tholos tomb over many centuries, the intermingled character of the skeletal material, the use of the open areas of the cemetery as places for non-funerary rituals, all point to a familiarity with beliefs about death and the dead which existed in Mesara and the Asterousia. However, we also observed a significant point of deviation in the mortuary ritual, which may suggest that the inhabitants of Livari did not follow passively the mortuary practices of the Mesara. The cremation of the skeletal remains and the funerary offerings, which happened sometime between the primary burial and the secondary relocation, has not been seen in the Mesara or elsewhere in Crete, so far at least. Moreover, the use of the Tholos tomb not as a place of primary burial of the articulated dead, but as the final resting place of the disarticulated remains of the ancestors, is very different from what has been suggested for the Tholos cemetery of the Mesara and the Asterousia. The above may suggest not only differences in the mortuary ritual, but also in the beliefs and ideas concerning death, the dead, the ancestors, and the afterlife. Moving to material culture, it is also worth noting that the external context of the people of Rivari do not confine solely to Messara and Vestelusia. Our study showed definite imports from other areas as well, including the northeast and the north central Crete, and from further afield, perhaps even Cyclades. The silver objects and the calcite tempered pottery of the campus group may suggest some sort of knowledge about the Cycladic world, although these contexts were definitely mediated through the gateway communities of the north coast. In the case of the calcite tempered campus group pottery, it is interesting to know that not a single cell has been found so far in the Messara and the Esterousia. This implies differences between the inhabitants of Livari and of the Messara, not only in consumption strategies, but also in the networks of interaction they participated in too. It is also important to note that Mesorahi and Livari represent an anomaly to our present knowledge of Prepalatial Crete, not only because they are the earliest tholous tombs so far from the Messara Asterousia zone, but also because they follow mortuary practices very different from their neighboring communities. A comparative analysis of Mesorahi and Livari with their neighboring sites shows an increased degree of diversity even between cemeteries that are only a few kilometers apart. At Gournia and Moklos, burials were made inside built house tombs, at Psira in cyst graves, at Agia Fotia in subterranean rock cut chamber tombs, at Petras, Palekastro and Zakros in rock shelters and house tombs. The inhabitants of all the above sites choose to bury their dead in different types of tombs despite their proximity in space and time. This increased degree of heterogeneity constitutes a particular characteristic of East Crete, and to my opinion, it would be rather simplistic to interpret it as the result of population groups with different ethnic origin or cultural identity, especially considering the increased similarities in their material culture and the evidence for exchange and interaction. Mortuary practices are not normative rules followed passively by a group of people and dictated solely or exclusively by their ethnic and cultural identity. Rather, they are rituals that provide the opportunity for individuals or groups to express, mask, or distort social reality. On this basis, different types of tombs do not necessarily indicate people of different origin or identity, but could also be the result of different social aims or of different social structure. For this reason, it is important to focus on aspects of mortuary behavior rather than the typology of the burial facilities themselves. The basic characteristic of the tholous cemeteries is the collective use of the tombs by the entire community for many generations over several hundreds of years. It is accepted that through burial in monumental collective tombs, communities try to emphasize, reinforce, or enhance the unity, parity, or kin affiliation between their members, and conversely mask or diminish social differences that may exist and undermine this unity. Therefore, the use of a single collective tomb by the communities of Mesorahi and Livari, in contrast to other nearby communities, may be seen as the result of differences in the social structure or in the social strategies of these communities, rather than differences in ethnic or cultural identity. The fragmentation of the society in neighbor communities into smaller burial units may suggest that unity was not a primary objective or was maintained through other types of social practice. Consequently, the exceptionality of Mesorahi and Livari within the broader area of East Crete may not lie in the different origin or identity of their inhabitants, but rather in the structure and the social strategies of these communities, and the way these strategies were associated to and achieved through mortuary practices and funeral rituals. In the above context, it is important to emphasize that both Livari and Mesorahi occupy marginal agricultural environments in which the emphasis on social unity is of profound importance for the very existence and well-being of the community. Perhaps it is not coincidental that the settlement pattern of Mesorahi is very similar to that of Agiofarago in the Asterousia. As revealed by the surface survey, habitation and agricultural exploitation in the marginal environment of Mesorahi was based on small farmstead placed at a small distance between each other. It is possible, therefore, that by adapting the type of the communal tholous tomb, the inhabitants of Mesorahi try to retain the social cohesion of their fragmented community and express their indifference from neighboring communities. In other words, the Mesorahi Tholos tomb may have served as a symbol of unity for these isolated, short-lived, small farmsteads. At Livarion, on the other hand, the picture is different, since the entire population lived in a small village similar to other settlements along the south coast, like Mythos Furnu Corifi and Tripiti. Livari lies by the coast, across the sea routes. Livari lies by the coast, across the sea routes that connected East Crete with the Seleucia and the Messarach. Thus, in the case of Livari, the adoption of Tholos tomb may be seen as a deliberate choice by the local community to emphasize relations with the Messarach and Seleucia, whether blood affinities, cultural interaction, economic relations and exchange, or all of them. It should be noted, however, that the different way in which the communities of Mesorahi and Livari were structured in depth does not imply isolation or hostile relations with the neighboring communities. The strong similarities in the body of Mesorahi and Petras suggest participation in regional networks of interaction and integration in the cultural tradition of the broader Citia area. At Livari, this is even clearer, since the site imported Finnish artifacts not only from the Messarach Asterousia, but also from other distant areas, such as Mirabello, Citia, Krasi, and Archanes. To put it simply, even if the ethnic or cultural identities of the Livarian Mesorahi communities originate from the Messarach, something about which I doubt, at least for the case of Mesorahi, the choice to bury their dead inside communal Tholos tombs was not the result of a passive obedience to cultural norms, but rather an active strategy to achieve social goals. In Mesorahi, to retain social unity in a marginal and remote area, in Livari, to emphasize relations with the Messarach Asterousia area. Finally, what the two cemeteries suggest is that there existed extensive networks of interaction between even the most remote areas of Crete as early as the beginning of the 3rd millennium BC. Large-scale population movements over long distances cannot be substantiated by the existing evidence, but it seems certain that people, goods and ideas traveled rather frequently throughout the island as early as the beginning of the Early Bronze Age, enhancing cultural integration and creating distant networks of relevance that cross-cut natural borders and bounded material cultural distributions. Thank you very much.